Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Today, our guest lecture will be conducted by our guest lecturer, Mr. Satoru Seno, Master of Science. He is currently working at the Center of Materials Technology, Agency for the Assessment and Implementation of Technology, or Pusat Material Teknologi, Pusat Teknologi Material, Badan Pengkajian and Penerapan Teknologi. I'm your host, Dedy Wicaksono. I'm from the Department of Biomedical Engineering, Swiss German University. I will be moderating this lecture. So we are very honored that today we have Pak Seto as our guest lecturer. He will be presenting the development of orthopedic implant in Indonesia. Before he conducted his lecture, I would like to introduce shortly his curriculum vitae. He obtained his bachelor degree from Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology University in Melbourne, Australia, from Faculty of Engineering and Aerospace Engineering, where he was conducting his research on the examination of failure mechanism in woven composite loaded in tension. Then he obtained his Master of Science degree from Technische Universiteit Delft in the Netherlands, from the Faculty of Engineering and Aerospace Engineering, with research on the development of bamboo fiber reinforced polyimide composite. Currently, he is a doctoral degree student at Universitas Indonesia in the Nano Composite Department from the Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Sciences, with conducting research in the synthesis and characterization of natural fiber epoxy. So his main field is mostly in composite, but he is also currently at BPPT, being responsible and involved in the development of medical devices, especially orthopedic implants. So without ever, so we are very honored that we can have him today to present some of the work that has been done by his team at BPPT. Today's lecture is attended by students and from Swiss German University from various levels, as well as some of our guests from other universities, including two and or three from, if I may say, from overseas, one from India, one from Malaysia, and the other one our SU student from that is currently conducting her internship at Switzerland. So without further ado, I would like to give the time to Pak Satoru Seno to give his presentation on the development of orthopedic implant in Indonesia.
And deliver to you all the that's because of my limitation in getting all the information, because it's quite a big amount of data. So I'll try my best to give you a kind of overview, brief, short on the development of orthopedic implant in Indonesia. Especially, I put emphasis on the one that will have been developed in my institution, this BPPT. This is my quick brief of my curriculum that has been explained, mentioned by Prof. Dedy. Just to reiterate again, I've been doing this program since 2004, basically on the development of biomaterials for medical device. I also have been involved in different types of topics, not only in related with the medical application, but also other applications, because the BPPT has a different type of projects. As years goes by, we have to come up with the innovation, so we have to make ourselves be update with the current needs. So one of the topic or project that basically already in our focus is the development of local medical device, that is the implants, and not only a bone but also dental. And we have been able to produce a few of the patents related to biomaterials implant. It's related to the stainless steel based bone implant produced by investment casting method using the ferronickel based materials. And also we do also research based on the materials locally available, that is hydroxyapatite, that we use it for bone cement and bone graft. Also we are looking at materials that we'll be doing at, as bone cement and dental graft. So this is kind of program that we have been developing. So I try to start my presentation with the overview on the framework for the national development of medical device, because this is important as we develop the technology. We have to make sure that the technology are in need, urgent and very well available. That can be developed by our resource. So we have to put the concept first before we develop, because this is not kind of research-oriented project, but we try to make it as industrial-oriented or user-oriented program. So we try to look at the position of the R&D in relation with the industry needs. So we have to look at the regulation in this, in which this is very important in developing the this medical device, because we're going to put this product in our body. So they are quite stringent and strict regulation associated with this technology and product. So this is like a cascading development framework from the R&D, looking at the regulation policy. We try to see available regulation and how the supply chain is developed, what are the stakeholders involved, and what sort of assistance that we will need when we try to develop this product. And we look at more related with the industrial, because we try and strive to make this product as much as locally available. We want to develop self-reliance and independent industry, not depending on the imported product. And the academics and R&D institutions like BPT, LIPI, BATAN, are all work in hands in synergy in developing this product, so that we try to meet the regulation, and so that the product that we will deliver to the market or to the community will not make any problems or harms to the community or to the people. So this the information that's quite compact, but this basically the framework that we see that not only R&D involved, but also the regulators, policymakers, industry, and also community. So as the background of the development of a bone implant or orthopedic implant, we look at the motivation behind this development, because we see that as the there are quite increasing amount of demands in orthopedic implants, not only for traumatic implants but also for degenerative implants, and then these are quite very high as the life expectancy increase. And we also see increasing number of accidents, and there are many traffic accidents that happen, yeah, in our roads, in our daily lives. We see also some natural disasters like earthquake that are very often causing harms to human, like creating fractures. Yeah, so this is the because we live in the area that are prone to earthquake. So we are in the what do you call as the supermarket of we call a rim of fire. Yeah, that's where we are located in the volcano and like faulty zone that sometimes erupts and make some earthquake that's quite making disaster to people. And this basically the orthopedic implants are dominated by almost 92.4% imported, and this is quite big amount of number, and this is based on the data on 2017, and we have been spending on the medical device, not limited only to implants, is amount to 750 million, and this data based on the information gathered by APSAKI, the Association of Medical Device Producer, Indonesian Medical Device Producers APSAKI. And this been generating the development of the implants, and we're talking about quite amount of number budget that is spent, and they are not available at the moment locally available developed implants, and not to mention in our National Health Service Policy, BPJS, we have a constitution decree that mentioned about the availability of the pharmacies and medical device that are affordable for people. And in 2016, oh, there has been an economic policy package 11, which related to development of pharmaceuticals and medical device industries that should support the availability and the procurement of the local available medical device. And we also have regulation that issued by the Ministry of Health related with the Rencana Aksi, the action plan and the roadmap of the development of medical device and pharmacy industry. And the document mentioned about this urgency and needs to make an effort to accelerate the availability and the readiness of the industrial local locally industrial that can produce this medical device. And this has been quite in concern for different stakeholders, not only for academic and research institution, but also for the medical sectors and industry. So we try to make a collaboration that involving triple helix, but even now is pentahelix, ABGC, academic, business, government, and community, where BBT is in the lead. We have been in synergy with different local hospital that focus on the using the usage of the medical implant, industrial Zenith, for example, that is one of our industrial partner, and also Indonesian Orthopedic Surgery Expert Association. And we look at the Indonesian medical device. I'm sorry, the data we have up now up to 2018, we have been gathering data up to 2020 to 2024, now we look at the 75% of our national budget are allocated for the procurement of the medical device, and this has been fulfilled with the imported medical device. So if we can make available locally this medical device, that we can have saving quite a considerable amount of saving. So this could hopefully create in a big amount of saving in our national budgets, because we quite have been spend the budget for getting this imported medical device. As you're looking at this top right hand side diagram, circle diagram, we have 92.4% imported from overseas, and we're not sure about the quality of this medical device that we have. So what we can think of is that we would like to make the technology available in Indonesia, and then make the medical device under the supervision and also standardization of that internationally reference standard. So that's what we're looking at. If we're looking at the analysis of top 10 device area in 2020, which is this year, we have orthopedics as one of the top hit markets in the medical device after cardiologists and diagnostic imaging, with the market share of 33.8 US billion. And this is based on the data of the Evolut MedTech 2014. Now, coming up to the development of the biomedical implant as required by my colleague, I try to gather the information that we have and we have done, and is still currently going. And basically what we do is we try to make the bone implant based on SS3116L, which is non-corrosive, and we like to make this as much as possible with high volume and with this high speed of productivity. So this is basically illustrate the step-by-step stages of this production technique when we deal with this implant. So we make a design in the a pattern for the implant, and we put it in three dice three with capacity of having 40 pieces of implants, and the assembly is designed so that we can have what number of implants produced in one time. And then the next stage is to dip and coating the ceramic cells, and then we the waxing and firing the implants, and we put the implants basically in casting molten metal, and then for this we will have a result. We will produce relatively high number of implants at this moment. In this picture, we were doing a trial production of 500 and 900 pieces of implant using a molten metal SS316L, and this is a mixture of the ferronickel material, raw material obtained from PT Anika Tambang, located in Pomala, mixed with the commercially available alloying elements in order to create a medical grade SS3116L. And then after this we have a cast implant SS3116L. As you look at this, we have create or produce the implant, and we try to validate the result of our production in a mechanical testing by means of uniaxial tensile test, and then we and this is the finished products with 15 types of SS3116L bone implant, and this has been BPT Quick Win 2017, and we have been creating since then about 10 types plus 5 different type of implant traumatic SS3116L with different number of holes. And this is basically the illustration of investment casting. Basically what we did is make the tooling and pattern, and then we put the pattern in the form of a certain assembly, and we put a dipping and coating, and then we the waxing and firing, and we casting, and then we get the molten metal already put in the mold, and then we get the material from the individual castings, and then finishing, and basically these are the steps. So these are the illustration of the investment casting technology that we've developed because we want to make a high volume process in order to reduce the cost with higher relatively speed of productivity. And if you look at the composition of the materials, we set the materials composition based on the medical grade materials specified in the ISTM F138, where we fulfill the requirement of this composition of elements that has to be available in our material. We have carbon percentage less than 0.03 and silicon less than 0.75, and we have nickel in between 13 and 15. So this are the material composition of the resulting SS3116L, and we test based on the qualification criteria set by the ISTM F138, and we can prove that the testing results of the ultimate set strength are lies between 490 and 690, and the yield strength well above 190 megapascal, and the elongation 44.217% which is above 40 as the minimum elongation. So basically, we look at the technical advancement of this bone implant. The motivation why we choose this technology is that we want to make a high volume production. This is very beneficial when we looking at the mass production in one hit casting. We also have been able to obtain a near net shaping with the dimension accuracy close to our designated design and shape, and also we have been able incorporate the raw materials from locally available ferronickel from the area where PT Aneka Tambang has mines, where we can mix these materials as the one of the constituent materials for making this alloying elements. And thus, we can have a very competitive unit price of bone implant and is produced at high volume with high speed of productivity. So basically, this has been one of a unique achievement that we can obtain, especially when we compare with the ones that using machining, because it will lead to lead production time in relatively longer period. So these are the illustration of the long bone plate, yeah, the one that already been certified, and we have developed 22 types of bone implant with different number of holes, TCP, DCP, long plate, screw, and etc. And we, in this case, we actually have followed the process and the production chain in related with the requirement set by the Ministry of Health, where we basically produce the implants that develop with the commitment of the industry that has been our partners in developing the implant ready for production and certification. So we, in here, we 2016, we have achieved 10 new geometry plus 5 variants of implants, and we try in the industrial scale production, making around 900 pieces with the using the facility of the inline production of the our partner in Surabaya at this in this case, BBPT has been making cooperation since 2014 until now in developing the orthopedic implant. With one of them is PT Zenit Almat Precisindo, and we did some development and production with the industrial scale there, and basically they have been, the industry has successfully obtained the certification, production certification, as the requirement of the industry to produce the medical device. And so this is the basically what we did. Not only in that stage, but we also did another important step, which is very mandatory, that is related with the preclinical test, and we did in cooperation with the veterinary faculty, medical veterinary medical faculty in Bogor Agriculture Institute, where they have a facility in performing preclinical tests with the trial animal using the Streptodoli kind of rats, trial rats or mice that we put in our specimen into their bones, and we have some observation, and we have been able to get a good response of the bone tissue and hematology of the animals, that there's no response of any inflammation whatsoever, and there are no any cytotoxicity of the animals. And this after this we're looking at the clinical test, where we put in human, we and where we have to approach the doctors or medical staff. In this case, we have partners from medical faculty at the University of Indonesia at the moment, where we are still in close cooperation in developing different types of implants. And this is the types of stage that we have to follow and go through in order to get the product distribution permit. And later on, we try to make this available product list in the e-catalog, so that we know that our product innovation, in this case the bone implant, orthopedic implant, really beneficial not only for the industry but also ultimately for the patient, for the community, with a relatively cheaper price. So this is the basically the role of the process that we have to follow step by step from design production technology, where we go together to make the product and the different raw materials, and then we have to search for the certification and distribution permit along with the industry that we have as our partners, and then hopefully our product could have been able to be absorbed or bought by the government through the e-catalog product procurement. Hopefully this will create towards the utilization of domestic medical device, in particular the orthopedic bone implant. This is the life cycle for medical device. We look at the R&D clinical study. These are the certificate of production, and this tech, we put the design, development, and manufacturing, and packaging, labeling, distribution, up to advertising until disposal in one row, and this will illustrate the life cycle for medical device. And we like to have this bear in mind in all the our concern in how to develop the product of medical device. Otherwise, we cannot make a proper medical device properly and legally available in Indonesia, because this is the regulation that we have to follow and fulfill. So very important, we have the this in BPPT we have PUI MM, stands for Pusat Unggulan Itek Material Medis, or Medical Material Center for Excellence. We have been closely working with the people from Ministry of Health, and they are quite cooperative in working with us in giving us information how we develop the product properly and legally available. Excuse me. And this is the case, because I know that there is a participant here that is not from Indonesia, if I'm not mistaken. And this is quite important to give illustration how we actually develop and put this product in the market. We look at also the protocol for application in foreign countries, because industry might need to look at the not only market in Indonesia but also a market in overseas. So there is a scheme of evaluation, verification, and validation of this innovative product in available in partner countries that have to comply with this regulation. So we have actually have to fulfill or comply with the CPAKB or good medical device manufacturing, and also that's related with this certification of product, product certification, and CDAKB is related with the good medical device distribution. CPAKB stands for Salah Produksi Alat Kesehatan Yang Baik, dan CDAKB related with the good medical device distribution, cara distribusi alat kesehatan yang baik. Now, looking at the development of the orthopedic implant, especially in BPPT, that I know, we have been able to develop this process in follow with the life cycle process of the medical device, and we have been achieving and obtaining a product certification and distribution based on our innovative product developed in the industry, and we also have been able to register our implant in e-catalog with 50 bone implant type variant, and now we looking at different type of implant based on titanium alloy since 2019, and that's traumatic implant. Now we also looking at the development of the degenerative type of implant, which is called total hip replacement, and we are looking at the development of this total hip replacement and total knee replacement later after 2020 onwards. Now, I would like to give you information that the we have a priority program in our nation, which is called as the National Research Priority of PRN programs, and it is initiated in 2020. Basically, started from 2019, but is started. I will commence in 2020 up to 2024, and this will give you some information on the development of the orthopedic implant in Indonesia, because we are having this what do you call as consortium type of project, where we will going to make a massive collaboration among the stakeholders related with the development of the bone implant or orthopedic implant. BPPT has been appointed by the Ministry of Research and Technology in 2019 as the coordinator of the development of the orthopedic and dental implants flagship 2020 and 24, where we have a target program to create three new industry for traumatic implants. The one that we have developed so far using the SST116L, and next we will be using titanium alloy, and five new industries for degenerative implant. It's comprised of components of total hip replacement, total knee replacement, spinal implant, mini plate and screw, cranio-facial implant, and bone cement. It's related with the hydroxyapatite materials, and this will have to be achieved in within 5 years with the involvement of this around about 10 different parties coming from the academics, research institution, industry, regulatory body, and also associations. The LIPI, RSCM, FKUI, RSO, Rumah Sakit Ortopedi, RCBE, Research Center for Biomedical Engineering at the University of Indonesia, FKG Unpad, FT Undip, PT Zenit, PT Itoko, PT Pudak, and Ministry of Health. So this is quite a big, massive project. Now this is the the illustration of the development of orthopedic implant at this moment. The one that I would like to emphasize as the core of this presentation, that we will deal with the six key technology of orthopedic development. And we have been discussing this quite some time, around more or less 1 year in 2019, and we will deliver about 32 product derivations out of these six key technology, which are include a plate and screw system, nail system, external fixation system, spine system, arthroplasty system, bone graft, and polymer bone cement. So if first of all, we look at the spine orthopedy. At this moment, BBT has been doing a collaboration research with the Faculty of Medical at the University of Indonesia to perform a preclinical study in cadaver involving RSCM, RCBUE, and the industry, PT Ostenko and PT Zenith as the main producer of this spine implant, where we put this spine implant into the cadaver. Not yet the clinical, but it's preclinical. And we also have as not only implant, but screw, pedicle screw and titanium rod performed by FTUE, FKUE, LIPI, BPT, RCBUE, and UNER. And what we are doing is that we are trying to design, develop, engineer, and characterize the materials to create this newly developed spine implant. CBUE also going to create a mega prosthesis distal femur. Hello? Okay. And CT scan data FKUE LIPI, and also a bone cement where we have polymethylmethyl acrylate performed or produced by BPT, UNER, FKUE, and RSCM applied to all this THR component. Now we also have a screw plate based on stainless steel developed by BPT, LIPI, FKUE, and Zenith Almar. It's basically the traumatic implant, type of implant. And not only that, we will be also research on the total knee replacement and total hip replacement. And this is all in accordance with this National Research Priority Scheme program. We are going to not only develop in engineering means, but also we're going to test not only in preclinical, but also clinical test. And then we also will proceed with the product certification, distribution permit, and e-catalog. So hopefully this product will be delivered by the end of the next 5 years. And this is the work breakdown structures. Basically, BPT now developing a traumatic implant, and LIPI currently focused on the total knee replacement implant. While in this, we have four work breakdown structure. First WBS related with the research led by LIPI. Second WBS is on the development of the implant led by BPT, engineering and testing led by BPT for the WBS 3 and WBS 4. WBS BS 4 is on the operation where we are going to do the preclinical and clinical test of the implant, where Faculty of Medical at University of Indonesia and RSCM will be involved. So here we can look at the different type of development performed by different institution. Basically, this is nationwide in Indonesia. Their work in hand and systematically means in works coordinated by BBPT, where they have a specific focus target every year for every WBS. So we also have not only bone implant but also dental implant, because we have coming from the Faculty of Dentistry from the University of Pajajaran, join this program. We have also BPT also going to perform a collaborative research with FKG Unpad on the injectable dental cement and the dental tissue regeneration membrane. And the development phase, basically BPT will involve the participation from the industry, in which is case PT Itoko in Surakarta. They are already in good support to our development in the recent years, and we also having total knee replacement implant developed by Lippi. They are also developing not only research but also developing the product, and this is also the same as you go along this column, or the spine implant, mini plate screw implant performed by RCBE UE, and the dental implant downwards. So basically every work package are associated with the institution, different institution, different partners of industry. We have BPT work with the industry, with PT Itoko, with PT Zenit, but I'm not sure on the total knee replacement implant and mini plate screw implant, where Lippi and ACBUE are working on. They might have the appointed the industry that will work with them in order to produce this corresponding implant. So for BPPT, for the total hip replacement implant, we'll work closely with PT Itoko, while spine implant based on titanium, BPPT will work on with PT Zenit, and with respect to the dental implant, BPPT will work with PT Pudak Scientific in Bandung. And hopefully, at the end of the day, we will be able to apply this technology, innovative product, into the medical side, where the medical staff are ready, not only in WBS4, but also in WBS3, WBS2, WBS1. So they are already have a good contact with us as the engineers in giving the advice and information on the dimensions and specific
Hello, Pak Zetro. Are you still connected? Halo Pak Seto. Halo. Okay, there might be some Pak Seto, are you connected?
Yeah, I heard.
Okay, can you share again maybe?
Oh,
your screen?
The screen.
Yeah.
Okay. Wait. Is it on?
Yes, it is on, yes.
Okay, I'll continue. These are the step-by-step and yearly target of every single WBS, and this is more than welcome if Swiss German University or other partners that might be interested in and involving in the one of the project here. We actually open to the any kind of cooperation, and we actually are still in developing the memorandum of understanding MOU and the technical cooperation document or perjanjian kerjasama between these institutions. So these are the 2020 until 2024 with a different type of project, and we're looking at the different stages, and this will be monitored and evaluated by the Ministry for Research and Technology BRIN every year, twice a year, and how we actually develop and proceed with this project. However, the funding of this project at this moment is originated from the every participant of this institution. We have been we have been suggested to use our own budget in order to perform each of this WBS, the scope of this project. But the Ministry for Research and Technology mentioned that they might have a slightly amount of research that might be shared and given to the execution of the PRN program, but not quite big. So they, because they have around 41 PRN project at this moment running within this upcoming 5 years. One of them is the implant, the bone implant and dental implant flagship, which is this. So basically we are actually having this 7 key technology: plate and screw system, arthroplasty system, nail system, external fixation system, spine system, bone graft, polymer bone cement, that will be performed and developed within the next 5 years, where we having three fields of focus, which are first on the material design and concept performed by LIPI, University, University of Indonesia, and BPPT, and engineering and testing performed by BPPT, RSCM, RSO, LIPI, and different type of universities. And then the other circle related with the certification, clinical study, the permit distribution, and the standardization. At this moment, we actually try to put the concept for standardization in accordance with the regulation stipulated by the National Standardization Agency, BSN. BSN is quite excited to see we are actually developing our own bone orthopedic implant, and they actually they actually have identified that we didn't have any SNI related with the orthopedic implant. So we propose with the SS3116L as the as standardized implant, orthopedic implant to be endorsed by BSN. At the moment, the technical committee of this standardization is actually in coordination with the Ministry of Health, but now is taken from Ministry of Health to the National Standardization Agency. So this is quite amount of issue that we are looking at, not only the design, development, and characterization and research, but also beyond that, that might need to be our particular focus and concern that will lead to the success of the implementation of this technology. So this is the target roadmap, the development of the next 5 years of the national orthopedic implant development in Indonesia, because this is already been endorsed and has been put in the Ministry of Research and Technology Decree Peraturan Menteri Ristek Dikti nomor 38 tahun 2018. Ministry of Research and Science and Technology Decree number 38 year 2018 on the PRN 2020 up to 2024 under the heading of flagship of orthopedic implant and dental implant. So this will be the blueprint basically of the direction of the development of the bone orthopedic implant in Indonesia, because they have been involving many different institutions from 2020, developing in titanium bone plate, a spine implant, bone graft, and total hip replacement and bone cement. And we have a different level, L0, L1, L2. L0 means impact, means they have reached the certification level and permission, have already obtained the distribution permit. And L1 is this is another cascading. They reach the preclinical and clinical tested for spine implant, and for bone graft already perform industrial scale production. And L2 is the lowest level, means they are at the moment still in the research level and targeting the prototyping of the polymer bone cement and the total hip replacement with the dynamic test results. So these are this cascading of the yearly roadmap target for the orthopedic implant. So this year, 2020, all these institutions that involved have to focus on the realization of these targets. In which this case, for the traumatic implant, we have to be able to succeed in getting the distribution permit from the Ministry of Health. And then spine implant, we are actually dealing with the our partners at FKUI in setting up the clinical tests and preclinical tests in cadaver where we put our spine implant based on titanium alloy. And bone graft already put in production scale with PT Pudak. And THR also in PT Pudak, we are going to develop a 10 set of total hip replacement, dynamic test and mechanically test. In 2021, this L2 level will have to move up to L1 level as we go along these years. So the bone graft, before we have already performed production scale, now has to perform a clinical test, and polymer bone cement will have to be able to obtain a production industrial scale test. And for the total hip replacement, after we've done dynamic test this year, next year we'll need to have this THR set for the preclinical test. And in 2020, spine implant will have to get the distribution permit or izin edar. And bond graph also with izin edar with distribution permit, THR, total hip replacement with clinical test, and etc. So this is at the end of the day in 2024 we will have around 6 different type of orthopedic implant having certification and production distribution permit and ultimately registered in e-catalog, which are comprised of bone plate titanium, total hip replacement, bone graft, spine implant, dental cement, and total in total hip replacement. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There are five different type of bone orthopedic implant. So these are basically the impression that I would like to share with you all on the development of the orthopedic implant. Hopefully this will give some impression about the process, the requirement, and the ultimate goal of the development of orthopedic implant in Indonesia, and that will lead to the self-reliance and independence of the locally available medical device. And this would serve as the last slide for me, that we put emphasis on the application of reverse engineering, where it will serve as the means for the industrial transformation. Basically, what we do is that we will get the proven product, utilize the market already, and with the objective to systematically pursue the lack of technology advancement until we reach the capability of self-reliance production. Basically, this is the concept of the starting from the end and ending at the
Hello, Pak Seto. Your screen is missing. Your face, your video. Yes, you are until the reverse engineering slide.
Okay. So this is the last before the last page. Of the slide, basically we are what we did is based on the principle of reverse engineering, where we do this as part of industrial transformation when we want to make the innovation innovative product within shorter period of time, having identify the proven product which has been utilized by the market with the objective to pursue the lack of the advancement of the technology until we can gain the capability of the independent self-reliance production. So it's concept of starting from the end and ending at the start. And this is basically is the one that taught by the our four founding father, Professor Habibie, mentioned about the starting from the end and ending in the beginning. Then it is very well makes sense and logic if we can do this approach, because the technology already proven and well available in every countries. So thank you very much for your attention. So I'm more than happy to receive response from you and feedbacks if any available. Thank you. Please, Dr. Dedi.
Okay. Thank you, Pak Seto, for giving a very interesting presentation. Wait a while. So I think we can now move to the question and answer session, yeah, where we will take maybe several questions from the audience, which would like to ask about maybe some aspect. I think it was clear that the research and development that currently conducted by Pak Seto and his team at BPPT is very much industrial oriented, and I think it's very good. And because in order that for us in Indonesia we could be self-sufficient in providing these implants. Yeah? Okay, I would like to open the floor or the room. Not, there is no actual floor here. The meeting room, the online meeting room, for any questions. You may raise your hand. Yeah, if you look at dear participants, if you look at the participant level, there is a facility that you could raise your hand, so that I know who among you wants to ask questions. Alternatively, you could also write your question in the chat, in the Zoom group chat, so that then I can read it and then to everyone. Yeah? So anyone, maybe any questions from the students, senior students, sophomore students? We have here senior student, as 8th semester student,
yes,
and then also 4th semester student who is just awesome. They are just learning about biomaterials. They will learn some of this aspect about metals, ceramics.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, but not that detailed to the processing yet. There's some basic aspect. So as well as our guests from other universities, you are welcome to raise question if you like.
There's one there, Miss Larasati.
Yes, from IPB, from IPB Bogor.
Yes, thank you for your time. First of all, I would like to thank you very much about the presentation, because I'm a veterinary student, so I don't really understand about technology that much. It's been really insightful for me. I want to ask, do you compromise with any kind of quality compared to the imported goods, the same goods, which is the orthopedic implants, compared to those who were imported before to our country? What are the main differences that makes the local ones lower in the cost of makings, and does that compromise with the quality of the product or no? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Halo, halo Pak Dedi.
Ya, halo, sorry, I invite. Yeah. If you want to share your screen, I can stop sharing my screen then.
That's okay, I can just answer.
Okay, yes, please.
Okay, thank you for the question. It's very good one. I'd like to answer with the information that we have actually have make a benchmarking study with the different type of implant product with a different brand taken from the different country maker. At the moment there are 3 or 4 widely available imported brand of orthopedic implant that be used in our daily application of the orthopedics. And we, in our preclinical study, we did some tests compared with our developed implant. And we set the different parameters based on the biocompatibility, cytotoxicity, the amount of life cells that can survive with the insertion of this implant at the trial animal. Are you coming from the veterinary faculty? Yes, in Bogor Agricultural Institute. Yeah, we are actually doing some research on this with Professor Denny Noviana. You might know him. There are some veterinary we call attending veterinary, and also some final year student did some research with our samples, and we set the with positive and standard with different benchmarking from the different brand. So what we can conclude that our product, our developed product, our research of the materials that developed for this implant has shown comparatively better than the one that are commercially available. For example, the one from European brand product, it shows about 72% living cell exists compared to ours that shows 89% or 90% of living bacteria still exists. Okay, and yes, that's the first one. And second one, on the mechanical properties. On the mechanical properties, as you see from my share screen, I have mentioned about the mechanical properties set by the ISTM F138 as the standard mechanical properties of the medical grade orthopedic implant. So that's the criteria basically. So we not basically looking at which one better or not, but we are looking at the one that fulfill within the range of the requirement or the one state by the ISTM. So that's the important thing to note. So we did also do the mechanical properties as the comparison study with the one that we import from the overseas, and we try to perform flexible tests and then uniaxial tensile tests, and it shows that both of them relatively are at comparable properties around 600 megapascal for the ultimate yield strength. For the ultimate strength is about 450 megapascal. So that's the what the comparative study. So I guess it's a good way to establish that we can validate the properties of the materials and also the performance of the component with the one that that is imported from overseas, so that we can understand the position of our research where we can surpass the values, or we are at the level of the values, or we are below the values. So I think it's a good way. And it's good questions, and we can establish that the result of the experiments basically in comparative with the one that owned by the competitive product, the imported product. So is it clear enough?
Mbak Ibu Larasati, is it clear enough from Pak Seto? Do you still want to ask more questions?
Do you hear my voice clearly?
Yes, I can hear you. I think.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Otherwise, if it is quite clear, maybe there are other questions. Students, please ask questions. It is not easy to get Pak Seto to give us guest lecture here because he is very busy, as you can see from the roadmap. He is leading many things. Or maybe from lecturers. Pak Maru, there's one question. Timotius Christopher, yes, please.
My name is Christo. I'm a SGU student.
Yeah.
So I want to ask. You did mention the material that you use is ferronickel, isn't it? Ferronickel.
Yeah, ferronickel. Yeah.
Okay. So I want to ask: is there any expire when we use it as a plate and screw? Is there a period of time that we need to take it out from the human body?
Yeah.
So we need a secondary surgery.
Yeah.
So I think that's quite my question. Thank you.
Yeah. What is the name of the student? I'm sorry.
Christo.
Okay.
Yes.
Christo. Yeah. Okay, Christo, thank you for the questions. I understand what your question is. So you ask me whether I have to take out the implant after it's being put in place in the human body. In some after time, I have to take it out.
Yes.
Is it correct?
Yes.
And the question is why or what do you ask actually? Why
do we need to take it out, or we can just leave it in there?
Yes. So basically, this is a preliminary stage of the development of the bone implant at BPPT, but in particular, where we try to utilize the locally available constituent elements to be mixed with the alloying elements. We have a different type of alloying elements, not only ferronickel, but also you have silicon, you have mangan, you have carbon, etc. Yeah, that's based on our composition. Because this is not a permanent, what do you call, this is not permanent organic orthopedic implant, we have to take it out for some, after some time. So after a few years, we have to take it out and we have to make a secondary surgery. And then we have to check whether it already heals the fracture.
Okay.
So we have to look at the position of the fracture, also the movement of the people, the person, and also the age of the person. Basically, these are the three main factors relating with the application of the SS3116L bone implant. That's why we move further on with this program on the development of the titanium-based alloy implant, where we will do a certain production technique. It's called vacuum arc melting FEM method in order to put and make the prototype of the titanium alloy as our main materials for the new implant, and that will serve as the permanent implant. why we developed the SS3116L is also motivated by the lack of the availability of the low cost implant crystal. Compared to the titanium implant, the price ratio is about four times higher of the titanium compared to the stainless steel, and that's sometimes being the first option for the doctors to perform the surgery with respect to the capability of the patient to cover the medical costs, especially those patients living in remote areas or in other regions of the country. So that's still being used at the moment. BPT with its innovative product has been making collaboration in the production of this implant with the industry in Surabaya, and they managed to have kind of order from the different local hospitals in Bali, in North Sulawesi, in Southern Sulawesi, and also in North Sumatra. However, in some many big main local hospital in Jakarta, or in other big cities, they are already moving away from stainless steel, but more embracing the titanium implant, based implant. So that's the reasons, and that's why. And yes, the question, the answer is yes. We have to take the implant out of the patients. Is it clear, Christo?
Yes, it is.
Thank you, Pak Seto and Christo also for the question. Are there any other questions? Pak Maruli? Yes, Pak Maruli, please. Pak Maruli, please unmute your Zoom.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
I cannot hear Pak Deddy.
Yeah, Pak Maruli, we cannot hear you. Can you check again your audio connection? Pak Maruli, we cannot hear you.
Yes. Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, we can hear you now. Okay.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Pak Seto, for your nice presentation. Yeah.
Thank you, Pak.
No, your audio is lost again, Pak Maruli. Okay, no disconnected maybe. So, still there? Okay.
Still there.
Yes.
Yeah, yes, doing that. Okay.
Again, yeah, you have my question. Hello?
Hello, Pak. Yeah.
Yeah. Do you have already your product available on the market now?
Yes, we have, Pak. We have already.
Yeah.
We have already.
Oh, nicely.
In the market, yes. In the market. In LKPP, Ikatalo, also, in particular, the industry has already performed some marketing activities using this implant.
Mm-hmm.
And they already have a good response from the medical doctors, orthopedics, and we have already had a donation to the victims of the earthquake in Palu and in Sinabung, Pak. It's the donation.
Yes.
In form of implants. In addition to the order of the implant, and now going to be what do you call to be ordered by RSCM, RSCM, Pak. But because the they have a kind of system that they have to use the implant until finish, and then they have to, and then they can order. So it's called like what do you call I forgot the system.
Pending order, maybe.
Yeah. Apa ya Pak Dedi?
Pending order.
Jadi sistemnya tuh dia habis dulu baru bisa restocking again.
Okay. Yeah.
I forgot the.
I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. There's a nickname for.
Yeah.
Nah, basically, so we have 22 type of variant already. Had permission of distribution, izin edar. Because if we want to sell legally, we have to have izin edar. We have to have distribution permission. Otherwise, it will be regarded as the one that is illegal. So we have to have AKD, Pak. AKD, AKD. Kalau if we buy an implant, there is a label in the packaging. AKL or AKD. If it's AKD, it is produced by local manufacturer. But if AKL is overseas,
luar negeri ya.
Yeah, overseas produced. Yeah.
So. Yes, thank you, Pak Seto, for your answer. Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome, Pak Maruli.
Thank you, Pak Maruli, for the question and also Pak Seto for the explanation. We have one question now from our student also, Elga Saki. Now she is actually now asking the question from Switzerland because she's actually currently conducting her internship in Switzerland. So she is joining from Switzerland. Elga, can you please throw your questions?
Hello.
Yes.
Thank you very much for your interesting talking. I want to continue question from Christo. If the implant is taken out from the body patient, is there any possible the implant can be reused again? Yes, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, interesting question. I haven't thought about this question before. Basically, we have been doing preclinical tests where we put the implant in the SBF, simulated body fluid, and then we put in a certain period of time, about 3 months, in in vivo and in vitro tests, and it shows that it still maintain its properties well. And we also have performed corrosion rate and corrosion resistance test of the materials, of these materials, and also performs a relative acceptable corrosion rate. I forgot the amount of rate at that time, but basically we are not recommending the orthopedic implant to be used again because we're not sure about the environment when the implant already put in the body of certain person. We have to retest again. There might be some fracture or there might be some defects or anything that might possibly be harmful to the another person. So what we can do is to remelting, and we try to get the constituent elements out of this implant. So we put it back into the molten dice where we put the materials, elements in mixture back to the furnace again, and then we try to mix again and we test again. we test again, we characterize again. We want to set that the medical grade is established based on the STM F138 that I've already shown you in my presentation. Especially the one that related with the composition of carbon has to be less than 0.03%. So that's the typical diagram, because we would not want to have the material be in region in a phase diagram. We want to have in austenitic thick phase. So we want to make sure that the material is well behaved in medical grade. That's the main criteria, the main requirement to be used again, if it's possible. So that's my answer, Ms. Elga. Is it clear for you?
Yeah, is it clear enough?
Where's Ms. Elga? I cannot see her face.
Yeah, she's somewhere there in Switzerland.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Your voice is very clearly from here.
Oh, okay. Okay,
thank you. We have one other student, Pak Seto, from
yes, sure.
Samuel Andrew, from this is senior student.
Okay, Andrew. Yes.
Please ask your question, Pat. Andrew.
Okay, thank you, Pak, for your presentation. I think I want to ask in continuation about the cytotoxicity level of the what do you call it, of the implant. Yeah. It has been met. You already answered from Crystal's question that it has to be removed at some point after sometimes, right? After being implanted. Now, how long in usual on a regular, secara standarnya, how long does it take? How long is the required time for the implants to be taken out of the body? And does different implants also mean different lifespan in different parts of the body, or how does it work? But you get it? But
yes, I understand.
Okay, thank you very much.
Samuel, yes?
Yeah, but
yes, thanks, Sam. Okay. As I mentioned before, that the different type of implants will behave differently based on the environment that it's exposed to the vicinity of the implant. So it's again we have to check the we have to pay attention and looking at the different age of the patient, of the people, and the way or the nature of the movement of the people during which this implant is put in place in within the body. And then there are two things most importantly to be pay attention. So we want to have this healing ability to be exist as fast as possible, and then the orthopedic will look at the possibly to remove the implant. So the question is how long will it be typically be able to remove the implant from the body? Well, I cannot say to be precise, honestly, Sam, because when I asked the medical people, the doctor, orthopedics, they mentioned different type of answers differently. No precise exact numbers. So could be several months, or could be 1 year, yeah, or even 2 years, yeah. If we have younger ages, then it will be more easy for the bone to heal itself with the existence of this implant, but then it we have older people, then it will be more it will take a lot longer period of time to heal. So that's my answer. So well, it depends on the patients, the nature of the patients, the ages, the weight of the patients, also will be the governing factors of the duration in which we can put this bone implant in the body. So that's my response. Yeah. Again, that's on the decision of the doctors itself. Looking at the result of the Ronson X-ray performed on regular basis, or 3, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months, yeah, every three months. So that's the how do they look at the development of the osteointegrity of the implant with the surrounding bone tissue. So that's one type of implant is called cemented implant, where we put a coating, like kind of hydroxyapatite, on the surface of the metal base implant, in order to get more bioresorbability and osteointegrity of the material with the surrounding bone tissue. So that's the my answer. Is that only one answer? One question, yeah. What is the typical?
Apa the regular time yang harusnya untuk dicabut implant?
Regular time, yes.
Yeah, that's already. And can I ask a follow up question? Sorry, just asking.
Sure.
What sort of side effect reaction that could occur to the body if, for example, the implant that should have been scheduled to be removed hasn't been removed yet?
Okay. Yes, it's also good questions. This is more related with the biocompatibility and bio resorbability of the materials. So we have done preclinical tests at this moment using the animals up to six months. So we did some experiment, and we observed the response of the tissue and the cells that develop in the surrounding implant. And then it says that it can be seen that there are some inflammatory inflammation surrounding the bone tissue. If we're not removing the implant out of the position, after which we have established the structural integrity of the fracture of the implant, because the development of the bone tissue might hit or might be obstructed by the presence of the implant. We know that the objective of the position or the insertion of the implant is to make the like a kind of bridge or as the assistance in the bone growth development. Yeah. Now, at the moment where the bone growth development has already in place and is already integrated, the presence of this it might be growing, it might create like an obstruction, and it might lead to a kind of painful feeling, yeah, for some patients, especially in certain maneuver or certain movement. So they have to have be able to be taken out from the body after some time. That's why they have to have a follow regular check of the development of the bone growth. That's my answer, Sam.
Okay, since time is already almost up, so I think I believe there are many other questions that you would like to ask. I myself have many questions, but I think for me to give first is to give priority first for the audience. Yeah, I think. But because of the time limitation, I think we have to end our Zoominar session. Thank you for Pak Seto who has yes. given his time to give this and also to the audience. To close this session, this seminar, I would like to request humbly everyone to show your video so that I can take it as a report, yeah, as a documentation when everything your faces are here. So as a token, yeah, as a documentation, like when we take picture together. So can those who are not shy,
I
can
see course. Many faces here.
Yeah,
I could see many faces.
Yeah, show your faces. Those who are not shy.
I want to know Dr. Dedi's students. So if
you are shy, no problem.
Yeah, I can say hello.
Yeah, yeah. These are not all of us. Some of are my our guests. Yeah, hello. From Malaysia, yes, NJ Riyad.
Yeah, thank from you. Malaysia?
Yes. Okay, okay, I will just take picture also with whoever has appeared here. yeah. Okay, thank you. With that, that's all, I think. Thank you very much. I will end the meeting. And we will upload into the YouTube, the recording, so that you can review again what Pak Seto has presented. Thank you. Assalamualaikum and good afternoon everyone. Have a nice day. Yeah. Bye bye.
Afternoon. Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you Pak Dedi. Thank you everyone. Thank you.
Thank you Kak. Thank you Pak Seto.
Bye bye. Success for you. Stay healthy.
Thank you Pak.
Thank you Pak.